so excited to be up here today. The more conversations I've had with the folks leading up to this moment, the more I'm just kind of excited to have this kind of dialogue in this kind of way about this kind of topic. So I've named it the Crystal Ball Challenge because this is a little bit about looking into the future, and it's a little fuzzy, and trying to think ahead on some of the stuff that, we're all doing day to day. So I work at a company called Huge, and my specialty is e-commerce and, retail. So I do both in store as well as work in the digital space. And of course, we're a digital company, so it starts there for me. So let's talk about this topic, anticipatory retail. But before I get all the way into that topic, I want to try to convince you of three particular things that I want you to hopefully believe by the end of my session. The first is this. The future was yesterday. We're already in trouble. It's past us. It's too late. We should all be panicking. It's all over. This is the scary part of like what it means to be in the modern day and age, and I'm going to talk a little bit about, that and then how it impacts customers. The second is a little bit of a case study of sorts, at least a topical case study, around e-commerce search, because I think it's about to be disrupted in a really, really big way. And so I'll talk a little bit about what I see coming and would love to hear in the Q&A a bit more about what you guys see coming too. And then finally, that all kind of leads up to this big idea around anticipatory retail being the next big thing. So let's dive in. The future was yesterday. Like I said, we're already in trouble. This was one of the scariest stats I've ever read about, which is that currently, in one day, we're able to produce as much data as we did in the history of mankind up until 2003. That's more than 5 exabytes of data a day. That's insane. And that stat's from 2013, so I can only imagine it's gotten worse since then. That's completely crazy. And when you start to think about it, if you ever, I kind of rediscovered this site lately, I don't know if any of you have been on it. It's like staring into the abyss of the internet. So if you guys don't mind bringing it up, we'll stare into that abyss together for just a second. So this is basically, a site that just tells you what's going on. And this is a great way to panic, if you'd ever like to. You're in trouble. This is just nuts. Like, how do you even track this and stay on top of this? And if you go then to the 1 second area of this site, it basically just starts tracking in 1 second, and every second there are this many tweets. And then you see in the corner, even since you've loaded this page, how all these numbers are jumping. Skype calls, gigabytes of internet traffic, it just keeps going. And then you get to Google searches. This number should be a really big number. It turns out that the YouTube video number is twice as big as that one. So you just have like the reams and reams of data. So we're all panicking. And that's partly then leads to, let me jump back for a second. So my kind of scary point in all this is that if technology has a sound barrier, we've broken it. We're at this pace that is quite intense, and we've never really been at before. But let's talk a little bit about what that impact is for you guys in this room, and for all of your customers. In a very non-scientific way, someone has tried to guess at how many decisions we make in a day and came up with the number 35,000. And no one's been able to be more scientific than that to actually figure out the real number. But that's nuts, 35,000 decisions a day. And if you guys have been up for 5 hours already, you've already made at least 5,000 of them. Like, that's crazy. You know, that's a lot of thinking and a lot of work. And it's a lot of work that your customers are doing. And so I think we're facing a very real problem that comes with needing to make that many decisions with that much data around you and that much content to try to sift through. And it's decision fatigue. It's this idea of like, how do I actually feel confident that I'm doing the right thing? And it's kind of exhausting. I mean, I'm hoping that in seeing all that data, you just were like, oh, let me lie down and go back to sleep. This is too much, right? And what's interesting is that people are trying to solve this in very fascinating and even uncomfortable ways. How many of you guys know what Soylent is? I think in California, you guys know this better than in on the East Coast. So about 15% of you raised your hands. Soylent is this crazy product created by a developer who basically said, my model is, I want to rinse and repeat and do things that I do every day. I want to make that an automated system. And his version of an automated system was to develop a powder that, when mixed with water, is nutritionally complete, so that he could have breakfast, lunch, and dinner be about mixing a powder, and then he could just go on with his day. He wanted to sort of take cooking and selecting food, all of that, out of the equation, which to me sounds horrible because I love great food. But it's a fascinating problem. You think about someone like Obama or Steve Jobs, they wear the same outfit every day. You know, is kind of, they're notorious for that. Here's another one, another company that's trying to solve this problem about decision fatigue called Digit. And what Digit does is it actually, you connect it so it can see your financial habits. You connect it to your bank accounts. And it peeks in, takes a look, and as it sees your spending habits, predicts how much that it can siphon off into your savings account every day, every week. Like, it just takes a little bit whenever it knows that there's enough there for you to cover your typical spending at that time of the month. Like, it's not like rounding up, keep the change. It's actually sort of watching, and then the amount it takes differs all the time as it kind of pays attention to you. And it's trying to basically keep you from having to worry about saving or actively kind of make decisions about it. It just sort of is doing it on the side for you, right? So I think that those examples sort of sit a bit outside of the retail specific space, but I think decision fatigue is a very, very real problem for retail. And I imagine you've even spent the last 2.5 days discussing that problem in other talks that you've had, because figuring out how to get people to the right product is the crux of the retail problem, right? So this is where I kind of want to bring in search as a case study and as something to think about. So search, in many ways, is a way to reach decisions and a way to figure out what you're going to do. And this is where I think some disruption is probably in order. So when I say search, I'm not really talking about Google, the sort of big G search, but actually trying to talk about the internal search and the different ways that we actually allow our customers within our owned worlds to find products. So I wanted to kind of give a rather crude history lesson of some of the sort of key developments in search that have happened. So we have, like, the internet is born and search is pretty plain and dumb. You put in a word, it checks for that word and gives you results, right? Then we get a little clever. We might add something like Boolean logic. You can put quotes around phrases so that the words have to be side by side. You might add the word and so that you know you want both things, or not, so that you rule out certain things and you list other words. Then you get something like this, corrective search. So now we're starting to help the user out. They were doing a lot of work with Boolean to try to figure out how to talk to a machine. Now the machine's trying to help them out a little bit and make it a little bit easier. Or we have things like predictive search, which I suspect many, if not most of you, have on your websites. A newer trend is starting to get into image search. This is a funny one that's actually been around for like a decade, but it wasn't very good at first, so it kind of went away, and now it's starting to come back a lot more. Instagram just put out one that's rather interesting, so it's starting to really show up in broader consumer spaces as well. And then finally, voice search, I think, is like kind of the next hot topic of trying to figure out how we find stuff. But this is what I believe. You can have all these innovations and all those changes over time. We've make it easier and easier for someone to enter something into a text box or say it out loud and run a query. But I think we're right there, my very scientific arrow right there, pointing to the exact spot that I think we're at. And that's because I think something really big and new is coming. And this is the challenge. I think search has been in a box, right, in many ways, literally and figuratively. The two problems are that it always required users to know what they were looking for, and they had to figure out how to talk to a system to get it. And so it means that you end up with users who inherently fall into two halves, right? And I think many of you might think about even your site this way, right? You've got the searcher, who knows roughly what they want, and the browser, who will know it when they see it, and they have to kind of wander and view stuff visually before they know what they're going to find. And what I think is the big disruption is that search is about to become way friendlier and potentially much more powerful for the browser types, so that browsing just won't be the same again, so that they'll actually be able to discover the products they want without knowing what to even search for in the first place. So that all sounds a little bit crazy. So I wanted to give you guys an example of a enabler to that. These guys are a search partner that works with retail companies. I'm not connected to them. I can't speak for them in and of themselves, but their pitch video is rather intriguing. And I wanted to play about a minute and a half for you guys so you can really see what I mean about kind of thinking differently about search.
Let's get it. A lot of difficulty finding the products they want. But if they had a system that could analyze everything there was to know about products, shopper needs, purchasing preferences, and leverage this to provide real-time assistance, finding the right product would become effortless. At Twiggle, we analyze every product from every category across every store and study how users search for products across all e-commerce sites, search engines, and social media. This provides us with a flexible and continually updated database that makes direct and relevant connections between users and products. Twiggle identified smartphone with best camera as a frequently searched e-commerce query over the past 2 months. Despite this query's popularity, leading commerce sites fail to understand its meaning. Commerce sites and apps typically use keyword matching to connect products with queries. This technique breaks down each user query into keywords that are scanned in product titles and descriptions. Twiggle does this better. We use flexible algorithms and machine learning to detect shopping intent across the entire product web. We decipher all possible meanings of the query, smartphone with best camera, and statistically identify the best match. We connect user intent signals to real data in order to extract the right products. Our smart ranking algorithms then score products according to their suitability for the shopper. First, we translate smartphone and its synonyms to a specific product category. Our system indicates this user might want products that are compatible with a smartphone, related smart tech products, or accessory.
But hopefully you got a sense from that, and if you're welcome to watch the rest of the video. Again, I'm not trying to sell their product particularly, but hopefully you got a sense from that of a really different way of thinking about search, because suddenly it isn't just keyword matching, but it's actually thinking a lot more about who's searching and then the real meaning, the human meaning behind that search, right? And that really leads to, oops, this is where I've got to click out of that. Hold on. So this, to me, and what Twiggle's up to really falls into this kind of path for where a search can head. So we begin with what they talked about as natural language processing, this idea that we really understand what people really meant. Then we move into something where we actually then begin to build even more personalized lens on top of that to the person who's acting that search out. And finally, I think we end up at a place that starts, for those of us sitting in this room, we would think, that actually felt like it read my mind. And so to really make this a little bit more concrete, it's that natural language processing would be more like searching like you think. Right, searching like you might say to a friend, oh, I've got to get a new fridge and I want to make sure that it's got, you know, side-by-side doors and it should be white, but I really wish it didn't make as much noise and I definitely just want the best deal. That thing you said to your friend, the idea that a machine could comprehend that and it wouldn't be a bunch of filters on the left side of the page is a really different expectation of search. Then you build on that the personalized layer. Suddenly, I just have to say, I want a white two-door fridge that doesn't make too much noise that's new. And the machine already knows I'm a value hunter who always checks reviews, that that's a key trigger for me, and already builds that into the way that it prioritizes the results set back to me. And then finally, and this is where I'm hoping all of you get a little scared, because this scares me even a little bit, there's the you read my mind part of this, where the system potentially is actually this one that's helping you search. Is actually more in lockstep with your fridge than you are and is able to actually recognize it's running suboptimally, propose that it might be time for an upgrade because it would save you money, already knows you're a value hunter who checks reviews, and presented with this need, You merely tweak what they're up to by saying you'd like to make it run a little quieter because it's an annoyance that's in your head that the machine hasn't perceived, right? So this idea that you've read my mind, suddenly we're in a space where retail and the act of actually deciding and buying is happening in partnership with search. It's in partnership with something that helps connect product to people. So that's an example of anticipatory retail, the kind of crux of what I want to talk about here today. So like I've said, I think it's a pretty big thing. So just to define that then, what I mean by anticipatory retail, because it isn't just search. It's machine intelligence that facilitates the discovery and delight in personal retail without the consumer having to direct it. And it, therefore, it inherently removes or lightens the burden of choice. So we're trying to get from that inundation of data, all that decision fatigue, into a place where someone's able to actually have a smoother and easier life. So as I said, it goes beyond search. And I wanted to give you guys a few examples of what I see out there that starts to do this. The first is likely really well known to you guys, the dash button. I'm assuming, yes? The dash button. So when I saw this, I immediately thought, what's interesting about this isn't that it's a perfect idea. What's interesting about this is that they're making an attempt to be more anticipatory because it's anticipating where you're going to want something. It's thinking ahead, and then the button itself comes programmed in such a way that what brand, where you'll buy it, what cost, when will it ship, and where will it ship are already built into it. We've never had a button that had those many factors built into it in commerce sitting in the spot where you're first having the thought of that need, right? You pour out the last of the detergent and you press a button. The leap from need to outcome is about 2 seconds. That's the shortest bridge that I can think of in retail between appetite and then completing task, right? But it gets beyond just that. I think anticipatory retail is really fascinating for folks in this room who think a lot about loyalty. Just last week, I got this email from Muntree. And Muntree is a food delivery service. They're on both coasts. And they wrote me this email saying, your Muntree delivery is about 15 minutes away. We credited you $5 as a token of apology for the tardiness. And what's amazing about this is they anticipated I would be mad. They thought ahead to how it might feel. The truth of it is, I hadn't even noticed because they're taking such good care of me that I don't even worry when they're gonna be late because I know they'll make up for that moment. So I'm not even anxious. I mean, I might have been hungry, but but I'm not necessarily sitting there angry or frustrated or anything like that because they have an aim of service and they communicate that aim and then anticipate that when they haven't met their own standard that they have to do something about that. That's amazing. And that's not super technologically complex. Anticipatory retail isn't just the impossible dream of mind reading. It's also just rooted in thinking about when people want something, how they're gonna want something, and how we can more closely remove the idea of technology and machine between as a layer between them being able to complete that task. I wanted to give another example too. I think it's omnichannel, and one of my dreams is, actually not this, oh, this is a lovely dream too, but I'm gonna sidebar for a minute. One of my dreams, if I could get, and I'm gonna just plant the seed with all of you, if I could get a retailer where I could shop online and build my cart, in particular an apparel retailer, and then I could walk into the store and the changing room would be filled with my cart, that would be amazing. I would go there all the time, and I would be in that cart, I'd be futzing with it constantly, I'd be having so much fun, and it would be a treat to show up then and have my own store built for me around what I was interested in. Like, that's amazing, and that's anticipatory and omnichannel, but that doesn't exist yet, so I couldn't put that in front of you as an idea. But if any of you wanna make that, I would love to help you because I think that's super cool. But here's a different omnichannel example. My employer has a lab cafe down in Atlanta. It's a real operating cafe, sells coffee. And it is trying to connect anticipatory better with its customers. So one of the pieces of functionality it's working on is this, which doesn't look like much today, but the idea here is that as the user is getting closer to the coffee shop, it recognizes location as well as the things that you've bought there before and asks you, maybe by a watch app, maybe by a text or other way, but asks you if you'd like to reorder and have it ready for you when you show up. So it's being smart about your habits and patterns and being smart about your location and using digital to sort of pre-serve you before you get into the cafe. And it's something that we're actually have in test lab actively in the cafe at the moment. And then I saw this morning and had to change the presentation to add this in, because the other piece of this, and I think the Huge Cafe is another example of this, it's the idea that anticipatory retail is something none of us have figured out yet. It's actually something that needs to be, that we need to test and learn about. And so this headline was on VentureBeat this morning, that IBM's Watson and Macy's are teaming up to do an in-store shopping assistant. So in 10 stores, they're going to have an assistant kind of bot, basically Watson, be available to customers, and you can go to a website, so it's a digital enhancement of your store visit. You can go to a website and then ask it questions like, where's the Oscar de la Renta fragrance, and it'll help you get there, for example. So it's an interesting foray, in my mind, into anticipatory design, trying to be ready, and I can only imagine the problem they're trying to solve is, I can't find a sales associate, and I can't find what I want, and it's helping me kind of reach content faster. So it really starts to get at this idea that I think has always been rumbling, especially in the last 2 years, there's kind of this growing discussion of service design, this idea that retail isn't just about product, it's actually about experience and service. That's a big part of what it means to have brands, have a relationship with the customer. So it isn't so much about some piece of functionality, but it's about a dialogue between the two. So I want to stop and shift a little bit here, because anticipatory retail, as cool as it may sound as I describe it, it also is fraught with danger and risks. And I think it's important to talk about that the minute you bring it up. And this is the risk. It's when you start to guess and anticipate something, there comes with that a cost of being wrong, as well as the probability that the person actually wants the thing that you're offering them, which kind of simplifies into there being kind of a bad side to anticipatory retail and a really good side. And I think some of the factors you might imagine for that cost of being wrong would be, how much is that cost? How easily is it returned or canceled? Can it be redeployed? Will you anger anyone? Is it dangerous if you're wrong? And then on the other side of things, it's just, is it the right thing? Is the time or place right? And is it the right user? So making sure that you've properly anticipated and you know who's on the other end of that anticipation. And that leads to this kind of ugly looking slide, where I don't think it's just as simple as bad and good. I actually think it's starting to break down into a category of anticipatory retail that should be in the don't bother, don't do that category, all the way down to the you can do this so confidently it can be invisible, which is where the Muntree example comes in, because it's actually not harming anyone and yet deeply delightful when you give me $5. Like, you can do that anytime you want. But somewhere in between is this idea where we may still want to be playing and may still want to be trying to anticipate people's needs, which requires us to either understand that the risk of being wrong is high enough that we need the user to actively select, or we sit on the other side and we say, great, the system's going to know and guess, but opt-out or control of that is still in play, that someone can still do something. I would be shocked if Muntree has a feature in their app where I can turn off $5 back, right? No one wants that. No one's trying to get rid of that feature. But that's because it belongs in the invisible category. And so if you can't say that no one would ever want to turn that off, then you have to think more richly about the way that you implement and thinking about anticipatory topics. So I think the impact, when done well, is that anticipatory services end up being something that we all come to deeply rely on, much the way we all rely on our cell phones today and other things around us, that this becomes something that we come to really, really love in the world around us. And actually that can be something that removes some of the barrier that technology naturally creates, that some of the issues around tech literacy that exists for probably many of your customers can actually be reduced when anticipatory is done right and done well. So I wanted to leave you with this thought, because I just talked about something like way up here and wanted to kind of talk about the fact that I think it starts down here, and give you just a couple thought starters that are in my mind to kind of get things going. So I think anticipatory retail starts with an attitude. It starts with wanting that and having that as a goal. And I think it's about shifting the attitude from the sort of historical place we've played, let's empower users, let's give them lots of choice, let's make sure they can get to everything and find it all the time, into this idea of service and serving users and thinking about the way that you can better anticipate and think through their needs, where they might have those needs, and how we can meet them. And so it gets from this idea of more choices and options to infinity to a just for me experience. So getting into something that comes back down to you. So these are then the, for me, thinkings around how to kind of get started with this. The first is I invite you all to find more ways to listen. To listen to your customers. And I just came in at the end of the last talk and heard a great note someone made about qualitative research and what it means to listen to people and know what they actually need and help solve, you know, what their real day-to-day challenges are. But listening isn't just research, it's also listening in you know, wherever their experience takes them. So whether that's research and shop-alongs, but also what your data tells you, and really understanding their needs. The next is being data hungry. And I have to say, in all the clients I work with, and whenever we start to kind of get to a topic that's kind of this lofty, one of the first sort of downsides of the topic is data, and that it's such a messy topic. And a lot of companies have a lot of data that they can't access very readily, that it can actually be really difficult. But I want to invite you all to make that a problem that gets solved and make that a real priority for the organization. And a piece of this, like an easy example, I just had this happen. I can't remember who did it to me. I was shopping on something online. It's cart clearing. Carts are such a great indicator of appetite and interest. They're a really great, I've often taken a lot of work to build a cart because I add a lot into my cart that's kind of like, ooh, that's cool, add to cart. And then I come back 2 hours later, a day later, a week later, and that cart is empty, and you've basically just screwed me as the customer on that. And it's one of those things where it'd be great for you to anticipate that I'm using my cart as a holding pen and that I really am thinking about it and that I may come back to you. And you should be talking to me by email anyway, probably, to get me to come back to you. But that's the beginning kernel of anticipatory retail, because you're trying to understand what people really need. And any brand can do that today. And then finally, the last kind of invitation I give is to care, because I think anticipatory retail is only going to work when the customers can trust the brands that are anticipating their needs and the brands that are interested in a relationship that intimate and that joined together. So in many ways, anticipatory retail requires an even deeper trust than I think most brands have worked out with their customers today, because it's so much more around privacy and data and information that everyone's a little bit skittish around still. So knowing that you're a brand that builds trust is actually a fantastic foundation that can lead you to be ready when this starts to really unfold. Your brand becomes has more permission to play down the road when this really becomes a bigger and bigger deal. So I tried to kind of summarize this into a 5-step readiness checklist. And this is really only the beginning. 5 sounded like a good number. I could probably do 12 or 15. But I think this then kind of summarizes it all. What data are you listening for today? Ask those questions. Find out, are you listening for the right things? What's getting really captured and absorbed into your systems? Like, who's listening for that data? What are you doing with it? What content about products or user would more closely match natural language? If you're thinking about the advancements in search, is there anything you can do to make sure that if someone says, I want something that where the door doesn't squeak as much, none of us have attributes that say squeaky or not, you know? And that's a real challenge when it comes to understanding information. And yet, your user reviews may very well mention it. And so there's an idea there that there's data where we're not always mining. The third one, I called it kind of a whiteboard session. It's to begin to think about where decision fatigue sits in your journeys today. Where are you putting burden on your customer that you can actually take back and remove? Where can you ease their lives a bit more? And then kind of thinking less about the removal of an angst, but then going the extra mile, half of it, is the next one. What kinds of needs or desires could you anticipate more? Where are you not playing at all that you can actually think even more about what that is? I think when you think about the dash button, what I'm fascinated by is how does the organization come up with that idea? And it isn't because they were just optimizing the website they already had, for example. It's because they thought more about what it meant for product and user to intersect. And so for that kind of to just be one digital button that happens to be a piece of hardware, but the idea that organizations can think that way about the user problem is to me really interesting. And finally, I don't think any of us do this alone. This is such a complicated, tangled issue. It's also about investigating partners. I threw in Blue Kai and Twiggle just because I know that they're playing a lot in some of these spaces as kind of supporting folks. I can't speak for these. I'm more on the on the experience design side than I am on the, like, you know, how does this front end plug into this back end side of it? So those aren't, that's a different talk. But I think that's important too, to realize you're not alone and that there's a lot of other folks thinking about this topic who can work with it too. And that's it. Thank you. So what I just talked about is kind of a little lofty, and what we wanted to do in crafting this talk is also have someone who's can speak to what it means to be in the weeds on this, in an organization that's starting to think this way. And so I wanted to bring up Janet and let her share with you her story, and then we'll do a Q&A, so keep thinking about your questions.
That is a really big photograph of me. Good morning. And Emily, thank you. That was great. And is anybody feeling a little uncomfortable about some of the things that Emily had to say? Yeah, it made me a little nervous. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about West Marine and where we're going and how we're starting to dip our toe into the water of this anticipatory retail. Who is West Marine? We have 260 retail locations, westmarine.com, our B2B business, which is portsupply.com, and we have over 4,000 associates in the field. So for us, we have a touch point with our customers that is not only our websites, but also very much in our retail locations. Also, we have shameless of me, I know, but we do have lots of positions open, not only in our Santa Cruz area office, but in a lot of our stores across the country. So in case you're interested in looking at what we have open, just a little plug there. This is a video about our company. And there's audio that goes with it. Oh, there we go.
Still don't know what I was waiting for, and my time was running wild, a million dead end streets and
changes.
So the first slide was of our founder 40 years ago in his garage selling rope, and the final image was our CEO on his paddleboard. So it shows you what we've gone through in the last 40 years. So I think it was really interesting yesterday when Jason said, look where we were 10 years ago. And now you look at this and see where we were 40 years ago. Something that we like to keep a really close tab on is who is our customer. So again, I'm going to entertain you just a little bit with another video. You can see from that video, we have a diverse customer base. There are people who are sailboaters, there are people who are powerboaters, fishermen, stand-up paddleboarders, surfers. We have our regular retail customer, we have our wholesale customer. So one of the things that we try to do is to be very focused on those customers and try not to lump them into great big buckets, because that's not going to serve our customers any more than it's going to serve us, because somebody who sails on the West Coast may be sailing very differently than somebody who's on the East Coast. Somebody who's cruising might be going from, maybe a snowbird who's going from New York to going through the Caribbean. There are just a lot of different things that our customers are doing, and so we're trying to keep a pulse on where our customers are going and what they need. We're trying to keep them in the forefront. We have again, just a variety of people who we are trying to serve. Some of them are a younger group of people that are trying stand-up paddleboarding for the first time, but a lot of them are boat owners, and they do work on their boats. They want to have us be able to deliver to them what they need, when they need it, and very quickly, because sometimes it's a matter of someone's business, if they're in the B2B business, whether they're able to service one of their customers quickly. But also, somebody's gone out for the weekend and now something's broken on their boat and they need to fix it so they can go out for the next weekend. Here's our current demographic. 88% male, 12% female, majority of them over 50 years old. They like Internet Explorer, Yahoo, and at one of our recent grand openings, we had a text to win contest that was going on. We had to try and figure out how to text people with using their flip phones, right? So our customer hasn't really moved technically into the digital age fully yet, but I think some of the things that Emily was pointing out might even be more comfortable for our customer who is not as technologically advanced. When you think about it, if they don't have to think about getting on the phone or going to their device or figuring out how to weed through the 120,000 products that we offer on our site, but that we were able to offer that smaller set to them or just from knowing what they've done in the past, but also anticipating some of the things that are happening to them on a seasonal basis. We're very weather dependent, so we can use some of the data that we have to be able to serve up those things to our customers much more quickly and probably much more accurately than we do today. Our customers, how they shop. 70% of our customers research online before they go into one of our retail locations to make a purchase. That means our customer is dependent on us for information, but they're also still dependent on our store location to be able to walk in and have that interaction with an associate and to be able to know that they have like people who are talking to them in a retail location. So what we wouldn't want to have our customer walk through the door of a West Marine and have them say, "Welcome, Janet." That would probably freak them out completely. But we can use the data that we have from them, what we're gathering online from their purchases online. We know when they're going into the stores. And we also know that our store, who is an omni-channel customer, they're spending 3 times as much with us as the person who is just transacting online or just transacting in our store. This tweet I found just before we came over and thought it was a great one to share. I think I saw Sutrita here actually earlier in the week. This is kind of one of those things we should be thinking about, okay, ooh, wow, AI, all of that is really pretty scary, and there's some things that we probably need to get right before we move into that. But again, not so scary if you're just thinking about taking little bits and pieces. What the things I think you have to watch out for are taking your customers, as I said earlier, and putting them into big buckets. That's what I call the lump effect. Don't put them into great big lumps of things so that you're trying to either market to them or to deliver merchandise to them in these big chunks, but that you're actually looking at them in smaller bites. Again, we have to be careful of the creepiness factor. I don't know if some of you, if you've had all of a sudden walk in a store and your phone starts texting you about things that you want to look at in the store. That gives me a little bit of a, ooh. And I think it would our customer as well because of the demographic that we have. Also, I think we have to be careful of all of us wanting everything all at once and racing to the end to be able to get there. Small bits and small steps, I think, are really important in any of us getting this technology right. And it's testing it in small bites. And maybe it is only in a couple of locations, if you have locations. And maybe it's only with a very small demographic to initially start looking at this. But trying not to get there absolutely at a breakneck speed as well. And this is where we are today. Today in our B2B business, we have requisition lists where our customer actually can reorder and keep buying the same types of things that they've been buying in the past. We're leveraging our loyalty program to know what types of things they're buying, what time of the year they're buying them. And we've started targeting regionally, so West Coast, East Coast, North, South, and looking at our customer segments where they are actually differing in the types of things that they are doing. And where we're heading. We're going to completely revamp our loyalty program. We believe that that is a place where we have a great opportunity to be listening to what our customers want, but also rewarding them for being our customers and gathering that data that we have from them. Personalization is another one that we've talked about a lot here today, and I think we're just very, very early in our stages of personalization, but really trying to take a look at where is it that we can add value for our customer and be much more activity-based in our merchandising and marketing. Our customers have passion for what they do, and they are in and around the water, and so we're trying to not be so about the merchandise, but more about what they are doing and what we can deliver to them. Our customers have a use for, most of these people have to have some kind of a safety device. So, for example, a life jacket, or maybe flares on their boat. And those kinds of things, they expire sometimes and they need to be reloaded or they need to be reordered, they need to be redone. So wouldn't that be great if we could be able to say, oh, okay, 6 months ago they bought this flare, it's going to expire, and let's make sure that we have that flare ready for them and actually have it in their hands before they think they need it. And that's part of maybe even moving into a subscription model. And again, moving beyond the purchase, but to what the customer is looking for and looking to do with their life and time on the water. The one thing I think that I haven't heard a lot of in the last couple of days, but I think the very key thing that we all have to think about in anything that we're doing is to not lose sight of the person that you're serving, and that is your customer. And think about your customer as we do every day as to what they're doing, what they're thinking, what are the barriers to getting them out on the water, because it's really what they want to do and it's really where our customer wants to be. So I'm going to leave you with, again, one more little entertaining video.
This is my ocean. You and I look at the same ocean, listen to the same ocean, but what I see and what I hear is not what you see and hear. Not exactly. But that's okay. It's a big ocean. Big enough for me to sail the ocean you paddle. He boats. They fish. And a father and son simply keep company. Big enough for her to find beauty in places you dare not go. Big enough for him to find peace where they find challenge. Big enough to grow from me to we, from mine to ours. Together indulging a shameless love for this remarkable blue expanse. Still, it's more than big enough for me to find my very own wonder in an ocean that for one delicious moment and sometimes days on end is mine and mine alone. And that's okay too. It's a big ocean.
And I'm gonna have Emily come back and join me here on the stage.
So cool to see. So the way we thought we'd do this is we have a few kind of questions that we had for each other because we thought we have such two really different vantage points that are interesting to just kick us off. And then we'd love if folks approach the mics or have questions and want to flag down any of the roving mics too. That would be great to hear from all of you on kind of how you digest a topic like this and what you're thinking about. I wanted to key in on something you actually said kind of two-thirds of the way through. You're trying to think less about the merchandise and more about, I know I didn't talk about it, I was going to ask you this, but
that's all right.
But more about like what they're doing and like kind of their passions.
Right.
Can you talk more about kind of some of the things you're, you know, kind of what that means, how you get the organization to think that way?
Well, and it's interesting because our merchandising group actually is really starting to think that way. And it's about setting, because our stores used to be these big, beautiful boxes of hardware because so many of our customers were boat owners and they were fixing their boat or they needed something to be able to get them out on the water. And we really recognized that we started to be really activity-based. So when you walk into our locations, and also on the website, we wanted people to be able to say, hey, this is what I need to be able to be a stand-up paddleboarder, and these are all the things I need to be able to do that. And that doesn't just mean you need a stand-up paddleboard, it means that you have to have a paddle, and the Coast Guard requires you to have a life vest or some kind of device that's a flotation device, and you might also want to make sure you're hydrated when you're out there on the water, so you probably need to have some kind of an item to take that. So we've really started looking at it much more holistically and thinking about it from start to finish of what is somebody going to do, and actually sometimes about what, how do you get out of the house, right? what do you need to get from your door to your car to where you're going, and what are the things that you would need to do that? Is that a backpack and making sure that you have your waterproof cases to be able to go out with? So there's just a plethora of things that we do offer, but we are trying to really hone it into that activity and experience.
I love that because you also called out weather as another data point, right? You think about the activity and think about the weather. Those are really interesting kind of things to key off of, I would think. And then the journey, like you said, door to
activity, right? To end of the journey or to the destination to start the journey. There are also some of the things that we look at. I think sometimes we should just all buy Farmer's Almanac and see what they predict for the weather, because we are so dependent on it. In some years, I think 2 years ago, we had a very, very cold winter in the Great Lakes. Memorial Day came around and there was still ice in the Great Lakes, and people couldn't get their boats in the water. And then this year we've had a little bit milder spring, and it's been great, and we're seeing a lot more usage of people and being able to get their boats in the water and to be able to go out and do the activities that they want to do.
Which is fascinating, because then they might run out of something sooner or break something sooner, you know, that you start to then tie that back to then the product needs that emerge because you might need to de-weatherize sooner than later or whatever it might be.
Exactly. And also, I mean, people have to do things like paint the bottom of their boats every couple of years because of just what the elements do to the bottom of a boat. So if someone didn't get their boat in the water last year, they're probably going to get their boat in the water this year, and then maybe this next spring they may have to be bottom painting it. So those are all anticipatory things that we have to think about when the weather affects us in different ways.
Yeah. One of the other things we talked about was sharing some of our favorite anticipatory things out there outside of, you know, our direct work.
Yeah, so I thought yesterday it was great to see Walgreens and some of the things they're doing, but I personally have experienced a couple of things. Sephora, I love walking into a Sephora. I don't find it unusual to walk in and have them text me and say, would you like to have a makeover at our brow bar, or would you like to go over and see, they're having a demo on how to apply eyeliner. I find that to be just really interesting, and that they're telling me to come along, and that they're actually making it feel almost like I'm being entertained when I'm in the store. Versus I was in Restoration Hardware recently and they started texting me and I was like, oh no, how do they know I'm in here? I didn't even know they had my contact information. So I think there's just the balance, and I think it's where we are and where all of our customers are at the time that they're starting to have these kind of experiences.
Yeah, one of mine is selfishly is Trunk Club, because it helps my husband so much. And what's interesting about that is that it's still human driven, right? You have this consultant who picks out the clothes and ships it to you and sort of anticipates when you might need to refresh wardrobe or get something new. But what's interesting is, I think, where I almost wish it were more data-driven is he has had to switch his, I don't know what they call it, but like the customer rep or his supportive...
His attendant or his consultant.
Yeah, whatever they call that there. And every time he switches, it's like ground zero again, like the data gets lost a little bit, like somehow there's no continuity. And so I think there's an interesting thing there where the experience is that, you know, how can data help kind of augment then the human factor? Because I think a lot of this is still very human. You know, how do we read need in a way that a machine never will?
And I think that's really interesting because at our office, Stitch Fix is a very popular boxes coming through our shipping departments, always looking and going, oh my God, how many more women are going to get Stitch Fix boxes? But I agree with you, because I found that many times I've commented or said, this style is not to my liking, this is not something I want to keep, I don't like this color, and I still continue to get things in that style or in that color. And so it was really interesting to me when the gentleman from Fabletics was up here and saying that they could predict 95% of their sell-through of the product that they were purchasing based on the behavior of their customers.
That's amazing.
And that was, I just would love to hear more about that, because obviously they're using the data that they're gathering from their customers in a very, very accurate way. And I think you're right, it would be nice if the data were being used to make sure that it's an enhanced experience and not a frustration.
Yeah. I wonder too, I think what's interesting in the stuff you've shared is it feels like your organization sort of, this idea that of anticipatory and being kind of an attitude, and how do you get an organization to think that way? Like, how do you turn a ship, or how do you get folks kind of starting to factor that in as they're directing products and channels and experiences.
I think it starts, as I mentioned, our CEO was in one of the last shots there. He's out on his stand-up paddleboard. He's very visionary. He's been with our company about 4 years, and we used to have, I think, 27 different strategies that we were going after every year, and some of them were digital, and some of them were stores, and some of them were very particular with a certain division, and he basically boiled it down and said, we're going to go after three, and e-commerce and the digital space has been one of the key initiatives of the organization, and we also have a new executive vice president of merchandising who's also on that same track. So I think it's just a matter of, we've been fortunate enough to have leadership that believes in it, and we have we're very closely communicating with those 4,000 associates every single day. Mm. So it's not, so there, it's something that goes from the top throughout the organization, and there's always places for us to be communicating that to our associates and our base of the people in our stores. So I think that's been probably one of the key factors in us really starting to move that direction.
I want to key off something you said earlier, which is around creep factor.
Yeah.
Because you and I both have kind of been like, there's an uncomfortable layer to this that's very real. And I think there's something I just heard the other day around kind of the automation of experience that can happen. You know, we have a lot of things that are sort of driving themselves, you know, like ad networks, for example, just sort of drive themselves in some respects. And someone was explaining to me they'd heard, this might be rumor, so forgive the potential lie I'm about to tell, but they had heard that Facebook has a sensitivity to advertising dating sites to folks who have marked their status as divorced, which we were talking about. It's like so funny because that would be presumably someone who wants to get back out there again and would want, but their philosophy, as it was then told to me three people down the telephone pole, was that if someone just changed their status and then immediately just got inundated with dating ads, that would pretty much be the worst thing that a machine could do, you know, that's just a terrible moment. And so there's something kind of fascinating that it's not just the creep factor, it's also like the accidental mean factor, you know, that can come from that, like what it means to automate something when you're not thinking about the human context of it.
Right, and how that would feel if you were that person who just was, you know, maybe letting everyone know that there was a change in your life, not necessarily wanting to have match.com in your backyard.
Yeah, how did they know? I wanna open it up a little bit and force you guys to talk with us a bit more if I could, because I think we've actually talked a lot about this topic, the two of us now, over the last several weeks, and I'd love to hear kind of how everyone in the audience is digesting, and, you know, does it feel expected, comfortable, familiar? Anyone burning questions?
Hi, I have a question. I'm Christelle, also from West Marine. And Emily, during your presentation, when we were talking about, you know, the far future where you wouldn't have to even naturally speak about which kind of refrigerator you wanted, it would just know that it's getting older and it's not as efficient. And the first thing that popped into my head was, how are we as retailers going to remain true to our customers and not sell that to companies as ads? You know, like how am I going to trust as a customer that my refrigerator really could be more energy efficient, and that you didn't, you know, that you don't have a partnership with LG to feed me that information on a particular basis?
Yeah, that's so good. Let's keep ourselves in the far future, because my answer is going to sit out there too. I'm going to sound crazy for 10 seconds, and then I'll try to sound normal again after that. I think actually that the service layer that you're interacting with in that moment is actually not potentially the brand talking to you. Like if Samsung tells me to change my fridge and it's a Samsung fridge and they just released a new one, I can't trust that. How could I ever trust that? And so I do think there's this like middle layer, and this is where I'm going to sound crazy. I actually think we end up with our own personalized bots. That instead of brands making bots, people get bots that brands work with, that the bots themselves have, and this is where I know I'm saying like really crazy stuff right now, but that's how I think when we get that far in the future, like I do think there's like a neutral layer or something that's like, and that idea, I mean, I don't know if it's a bot, we probably won't call it that, but the idea that that I have sort of digitally activated objects in my house that it then gives me status on feels really reasonable. You know, that it sits more in the consuming layer, that a product that you might put out there would have its own sense of its, you know, efficiency, that it reports on a weekly basis, and that if then it gets read a certain way, then it gets flagged. You know, that there's like potentially these extra communication layers, and that the brands then kind of work within that to say, great, when that happens, I want to be in play. You know, I want to be part of the response set that comes back, but not necessarily the one triggering it, because that's, I think, a dangerous, potentially risky spot maybe to be in.
Does anybody have Alexa in their house? Anybody?
I do.
Yeah, so yeah. Again, is that, I mean, I wonder, is that just the start of it? Because you're telling that device things that you want to remember, things that you want to purchase, right? I mean, it is.
I totally think so, yeah. And what's actually funny is that's from a retailer. So, mm-hmm.
Right.
But there's a lot of other folks fighting for that same space, whether it's like Cortana or Siri, or right. You know, that there are a lot of, that's a battleground that's mm-hmm. coming up fast and furious to figure out who's that partner for your life, you
right.
know.
Yeah, and how do you make that decision, and who's going to use that data, right? And
yeah.
That's, I think, another place we all have to look at and make those decisions of when you're buying your technology, who is it? Who's watching you?
Yeah. Creepy.
Oh, come on, you guys. We know you've got questions.
Oh, come talk to us at lunch. You might be hungry. Well, thank you all very much.
Thank you.